How's it going?
It's good.
Going.
Tired.
All right. ChiIL Mama Shows is here today in the basement of Reggie's with Black Tusk.
Howdy.
Do you want to just start with a quick little intro, your name and what you play?
I'm Ethan. I play bass and vocals.
Andrew, I play guitar. Sing, too.
And you guys all pretty much sing.
All three. Yep.
Yeah.
Excellent. So, I know you kind of mix it up. You get lumped in with metal bands, but I know you have a strong punk background as well. We've heard stuff. Love it.
It's true.
Yeah.
You've heard our old bands?
Your old bands?
Have you heard?
Old, yeah.
A little online, not live.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
But, yeah. A little bit online. So you do definitely come from a punk background.
Absolutely. Yeah, that was our upbringing. It was in the Savannah punk scene back in the day, and had a really strong scene back in the day, and that's kind of what we gravitated to, and then kind of evolved from there. Got our own little thing going on.
Like, when we were teenagers, like, Death of Damned was, you know, in their, you know, height of their popularity, so we're sneaking out to see Damned play, and there's this band called The Mugshots, and another band called Take 18, another band called Das Criminals. So we had this, all these great, like, crusty, kind of more crustier punk bands that were around Savannah. So that was what Savannah scene was, you know, especially like that whole South area, like Columbia and Savannah.
Right.
So we got to catch all that stuff, and, you know, it's huge influence on the two of us when we were, you know, coming up.
So all three of you were born and raised in Savannah?
No, I'm from Tennessee. I've been in Savannah for a long time, but I'm originally from Tennessee.
Me and James, the drummer, were born and raised in Savannah, so.
Yeah, I heard you guys all ended up on the same street, and that's how you kind of hooked up.
You've read Wikipedia.
Yeah.
I have. Is that true? Some of it is lies.
We were actually living in the same house, and James was living three doors down from us, basically, so three or four houses down, and we all ran in the same crew anyway, so it was, both of our bands basically broke up on the same week, I would say, and it was just like, oh, let's walk down the street and see if he wants to jam.
We're not done playing music or touring or any of this, so,
because,
you know, our other two members left our band because they didn't want to tour. Same problem James had with his band, half of the band didn't want to tour.
Yeah, it happens.
We're like, well, screw this, we can play music together, we can go on tour.
Right, so you'd already seen each other live in action, kind of knew each other from the scene.
Like, Ethan and I lived in the punk house. There was like six of us living in there, and the practice space was in our house. So it was like all of our gear and stuff was already there.
So. I didn't actually own gear at that time, I don't think.
Yeah, I was wondering if you were just walking down the street and went, this guy kicks ass, let's knock on the door and go, dude, join our band.
We'd known each other for years before that. Savannah's so small, you have to know everyone. And so it's just one of those things, like, we literally would either be at each other's house, you know, every night of the week, just hanging out because we were all friends, so.
Yeah.
Wasn't a bad deal.
I don't think I've ever really heard anyone else described as swamp metal.
we kind of coined that one. We were getting tired of getting lumped in with the rest of the long-haired buttholes. And,
you know, like, it's also like kind of tongue-in-cheek, too, because everyone's like, oh, you got to be this, if you're a metal band, what kind of metal are you?
Yeah, speed metal, thrash metal, death metal. Yeah, I hate labels.
We're not any of those things. I don't know what we are. And then,
I think as James said it the first time, and we just rolled with it, and we kind of doomed ourselves because now people are coining it as swamp metal, and it's like, fuck, we were trying to get away from these terms,
right?
And we just made another term for ourselves. So at least it's ours. You know, we know we're not getting thrown in with anybody else.
Exactly. It's creative and unique.
It started with us, so I guess we can keep it that way.
Nice. All right, so I got to ask, do you have any rituals before you go on and play?
Not really.
So nothing you do in particular before you just go out there and do it?
No,
just drink some beers, make sure our guitars are tuned. That's about it.
Yeah, just kind of, we're one of those bands, like, I don't know, if you try and ritualize it, you know, what happens if something goes wrong with the show? Is it your pre-ritual that messed it up? Or, like, what if you don't get a chance, you're late, and you have to just throw your stuff on the stage and go? It's like, I don't really have time to keep up with that crap.
Right.
Like, just get it done, you know, just play. That's what we're really about, is just having fun playing live anyway. It's not really the before or after. It's what we get to do while we're on stage. So
absolutely.
Everything else is kind of an afterthought.
Now, you guys just did a big European tour with Red Fang.
We did.
Awesome. Those guys are amazing dudes.
It was so fun.
Yeah, I've interviewed those guys, too. They're a lot of fun. They're hilarious. Do you guys hang out much? Or?
Yeah, we shared a Sprinter with them for a month.
Where was nothing but hanging out. Yeah.
There was, you know, every day, 24 hours, we were hanging out with those dudes. It's good to have been in a van with a better crew of dudes. It's awesome.
Yeah, so was Europe pretty fun? Good reception?
We've been there once before, and this time was just even better because Red Fang had just been there with Mastodon, so they hit a large crowd, and we had had a crowd from the time we went before, and with us two teaming up and having fun, it was awesome.
Yeah, almost every show was sold out.
Oh, sweet. So
it was packed full of kids every night, just going nuts, having fun.
Yeah.
Crowd surfing and stage diving. I got picked up off stage at one point when I was playing.
Oh, excellent. French anybody get it on video?
Crazy. No, I don't think so.
There wasn't enough room for video in there.
There was barely enough room for us in there.
Yeah.
It was pretty crazy. Oh, lots excellent. And lots of sweaty little venues jammed to the gills with people having fun.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Now, that's one thing I wanted to ask you. I know you're playing again with Red Fang in a couple of days. Big Outdoor Fest at 1 in the afternoon.
Yeah.
We are early. We're kicking it off.
Yeah, you are. So do you prefer sweaty little venues late night or outdoor fests, or does it not matter? It's totally different flavor.
They're different shows, you know?
Yeah.
Like, the outdoor festival is way different from the inside, you know, club show, so.
Something about daylight outside while you're playing a show is just weird to get used to, but it's still fun as long as there's people there enjoying it and interacting with you. It doesn't matter where you are. You can be in the middle of a cornfield. I wouldn't give a damn as long as we're having a good time.
Yeah, we saw Clutch at an outdoor fest, and it was the same thing. We were so stoked to see him. We've seen him at so many late night shows over the years, and yeah, it was like that. They played at like 3 in the afternoon in bright sunlight, and it was kind of like
We actually played a festival earlier on this tour, and it was an outdoor middle of the day thing. Suicidal played there as well, and it was so funny because I didn't really think about it. Like, you can't see your tuner pedal, so you have to like kind of shade it and make sure you're in tune. And at the end of the show, we're loading all of our gear out, and we got in the van and realized that we were all sunburnt because we didn't even register, like, oh yeah, we're playing a show, maybe we should put on some sunscreen, like, you know, intelligent people. Yeah, but
the sun's in your face.
Learning
lesson. We can't wear sunglasses when we play because they won't stay on.
Yeah, that makes sense, having seen you play a number of times. Absolutely. So I wanted to ask you about your writing. Is it pretty collaborative, or you have one principal lyricist?
No, it's absolutely a whole...
It's all three of us
together. All three of us together.
Every song on the record.
Kind of one person will come in with a drum beat or a guitar riff or humming something off of your phone that you recorded while you were grocery shopping. And everybody just kind of sits down and goes, all right, yeah, that's kind of cool. But what if we change it? Or where do we go from here? Is this a beginning or end or a middle or... You know, and once we get a couple songs done, we kind of feel how the songs are going, and that's when we start to evolve a thought for what the album's going to be.
Yeah.
And then the lyrics come in from there, and the title, and everything kind of just snowballs, and then the artwork gets brought in from that as well.
Yeah.
So it's all inclusive, and it's all hands on deck at every single aspect of it, basically.
Yeah. Now, speaking of your artwork, your album art is fantastic, and that's done by a musician.
John Basley from Baroness.
Friend of yours as well.
Yeah, he used to live down the street as well. Kind of like to keep it in the family, you know. And we got a little character going with him named Agatha, and she kind of embodies what all of our albums are about. So we kind of change her look and cater it towards each and individual album. And we're just going to keep rolling with it, you know. We've had a good time having fun playing with that so far, and of course every time we kind of push his boundaries a little bit farther of what we ask out of him, and he always gives us something even more than we thought it would be. So it's kind of fun, just, you know, pushing ourselves and then getting him excited about it, and then, you know, the artwork just feeds off the music and back and forth. So it's a pretty good little cohesive thing we've got going.
Yeah. Now, we've been talking to a lot of musicians that do other things, photography or art. Any of you guys, what do you do when you're not on stage?
I'm a photographer, and we're actually, James draws a whole bunch. He'll draw on old drum heads and sell them to people and give them away to when we go to like radio stations or something. He's done that stuff, and we'll hang them up in clubs or something. And it's just fun. When we're at home, we're very hands-on, active people. We don't like to just sit around.
Ethan and I both own little construction companies too, so we do that when we're at home.
Yeah, it's always got to have some kind of artistic outlet, even when we're not touring or writing. It's just we're not that kind of people who can sit around and do nothing.
Some of that's that same kind of energy, I think, just that if you're tapped into it, you know, it could come out as music or art or photography.
Yeah, it's, I mean, you have to get rid of it somehow or else it could get dangerous.
Yeah, right. So, you have any advice out there for all the little kids who want to be you?
Get a nice van and get on the road. Find a van that won't break down and some equipment that won't break down and do it. And that's about it. That's how we did it. And may not be the best way to go about it, but you'll definitely learn everything you're doing wrong very quickly.
But we did it without the nice van.
Yeah, we did it without the nice van and the nice equipment and spent half of our time playing mechanic. And, you know, it's a good way to bring down the mood. But I think if you want to earn it, is something cool about that.
So it'll add, does it
give you some material.
It gives you something to grow off of, and you know, you can sit back at the end of the day and be like, wow, you know, all that we went through to get here, it makes it so much better and so much more worth it.
We'll suffer for your art.
Yeah, right.
Build some character.
We got character for days then, if that's the case.
But you got some good skills. Yeah. You can fix a van.
Yeah.
There's something to be said for that. Now, do any of you guys have families yet? Or are you still?
No, we got pretty serious girlfriends, but
we have dogs.
And dogs.
Yeah.
We definitely all have dogs.
Yeah, I've got a dog and roommates, and it's basically a family. It's
pretty fun, absolutely. Yeah. That makes touring a little bit easier.
Yeah.
Yeah. Absolutely. All right. You want to add anything new? You guys have had what, 8 months, I guess, right, on your new album that's been out, something like that?
Yeah. Yeah. We've been on tour pretty much since it came out.
Yeah. Since the day it hits tours, I think we've been out on tour since then, so.
So you guys working on new material now, or are you still?
We're going to Europe after this.
We haven't
this
had time
show.
To work on new material yet.
Right, yeah, you guys have been busy.
Yeah, we have another European tour, and then another yet-to-be-announced U.S. tour coming up. And then that'll close the year out, and then we'll start writing again.
Excellent. Sounds like a plan. All right. Well, have a great show tonight.
Thank
Can't
you.
Wait to see you in action again.
Yeah. And we look forward to it.
Thanks a lot for taking the time to meet with us.
Absolutely.
Thank you, guys.